Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being here, and sorry to wake you so early. Hans told me that I have to speak about the technology and social change. You will see from what I'm going to do that I have no clue what technology is. I will probably be confused between this and this, but I'll try my best. So today I think it was very important coming from Egypt to speak about what I think is the democratization of technology and how this affected social change in Egypt and the Arab world. The first thing is, what do we mean by technology advancement? And I looked, doing this my homework for this presentation, I looked around, and technology advancement in general, whatever, in whatever field, shapes behavior. It changes how we act every day. But what I'm going to focus on is really the internet and the social media. To start with, what do I mean by democratization? It was important, but because it became very accessible, it was spread all over. If we look at, for example, the internet penetration that grew in Egypt from 12%, 12.6%, to 35%, from 12% in 2006 to 35% in 2011, which is huge. Mobile phone penetration grew from 24% in 2006 to 102% in 2011, which means that more people had access to technology, more people had access to these interesting applications, and were able to create their own world, and we'll see that. Not only this, but just to give an example, between January and April of 2011, during the revolution, 2 new million people were added to Facebook. Now, by 2011, the beginning of 2011, 17.16% of the population, which is really more than 60, around 64% of people online, are now most of the time on Facebook. So, I mean, this is very important. And I call it democratization because it reached people that were not, that are not just the elite. It reached a lot of upper middle class people. It's very important. Across the Arab world, in Tunisia, in Egypt, in Libya, and now in poor Bahrain and other places in Syria, the price for social reform before such uprising, we would not have known about as much if there was no technology. Before this, when you had traditional media, most of the media was controlled by governments. Very few were really not, and even the information was not so immediate as we have it now. So without the technologies that were available, without all the online internet and the bloggers, we would not have known a lot about the brutality, the corruption, all the problems that were taking place. But more important than anything, while the old regimes in the Arab world and middle-aged or even above middle-aged people like me were sleeping, the young people created their own world on the internet. The young people who were from 19 or 18 till maybe 25, 30, but majority were from 18 to 25, were there creating their own virtual world, were there mobilizing, were there talking, were there arranging and preparing for the revolution. And one of the main reasons for success was that everybody else was sleeping. We were sleeping, middle-aged people, and older people, and the government. Nobody knew. Actually, we always made fun of, our previous president was making fun of bloggers, making fun of people on the internet, because we didn't know the people were, I didn't know, the people were being tortured in the police stations that way. We didn't know that when Khaled Said, one kid was killed, and there were mobile phones, were pictures of even his body and how it was tortured. It was Khaled Said, this guy, who started everybody mobilizing for the 25th of January. It was his page called the page of Khaled Said that started, and his picture was all over the place because the government said he killed himself, and then everybody saw, because of the phone pictures, that no, he was tortured. So it was very important, from corruption, which was not touching everybody, to the brutality, which really awakened everybody. So that was very important. But not only this, social media started calling on all Egyptians to join. On the 25th of January, people were calling and saying, this is the day of the revolution. And just in one Facebook group, there were 85,000 people who said, we are going to join. Now, before this, in order for us to mobilize a demonstration or anything, the maximum we got was 1,000. Maybe some people came around and became 2,000, because there was no, that was when I was young, because there was no internet access. When the government banned the internet on the 28th of July or January, the government stopped all internet, stopped all mobile phones. The kids, circumvented this and really subverted this by having satellite mobiles, by having ISPs in Florida, in France and Sweden, which helped the people in Egypt. And even Twitter and Google created this phone call, voice tweets. And there were bloggers. These are really bloggers in Medan al-Tahrir. People used to sleep in Medan al-Tahrir, the Tahrir Square. And there was a corner for bloggers. But what was also very important, and I think problematic, maybe, is the Muslim Brotherhood, the Freedom and Justice, and the staff, which is the army, established armies, many people who were micro-bloggers. And the job was, and I'm attacked all the time on the Twitter, is whenever they see somebody who's criticizing them, they come in with an account of zero followers, and then they start calling you names, or spreading, or threatening you, or spreading rumors about you. Or for example, if we are supporting one person who's a symbol of the revolution, like Barad, you probably know him, they would come on the internet, on the Twitter and Facebook. We don't know who these people are, they just come in, and they start attacking. Kids who were creating a party or an army or a revolution on the online while we were sleeping did not know if the person they're talking to is a Muslim or Christian, a woman or a boy or a man, rich or poor. So it really created this mobilization and this one goal, which gave them a lot of energy and made them unified. So that's the good thing. What happened in the bad thing? Well, we keep on forgetting. Egypt has 25% ultra-poor, below the poverty. And I was talking to Ruth, we have 25% of women, especially in Upper Egypt, who are not educated, but in general, 50% of women who are not very savvy in technology, and they don't have access. And this created a social or economic and gender divide. So that was the first divide. One of the main problems, because of course, you know, I'm biased, was women. Women in the revolution, the first two pictures, these were the women in Egypt who were there beside men, were beaten, were killed, everything, they were there like men. But after the revolution, they're asked to be silent. There is a very organized violence against women in the streets so that they don't go out, so that they go home. And they're trying to change the laws. So we have Ashoka fellow Amani Tunsi, who decided, she created Banat Wubas, which is a radio on the internet. And she has, and the place in Banat Wubas means girls only. And the idea here is to address the taboo subject that nobody talks about. She has 5 million people following her. So, and many of them are men, not only in Egypt, but in the Arab world. So this is a very strong tool and weapon she's using to empower women to speak out, to speak about the violence they are facing, especially in the last 2 years. And finally, what I think is needed in the Middle East and Egypt is to develop, and here we're talking to all the innovators in the engineering school, we need to develop simple technology that goes to people that are uneducated. I mean, I'm not a technology expert, but if we really want to empower the powerless, the voiceless, we were able to do this for a long time for many groups, but if we want to reach the grassroots or the poorest of the poor, we really need to use technology to educate them in a faster way and to reach them, because they're missing out. I hope I'm not too long. Thank you very much.
I wonder if women associations, women groups, feminist organizations, etc., were also sleeping or awake, and what was their role, and if there's any connection with innovations, ITs, etc.
Okay. I want to tell you that when we started this at the U.S. University, we made a conscious decision. It was not something that came by luck. We sat there and said, simply, and we're sorry, and we were young then, it was 28 years ago, we said we will not go into politics because we cannot change anything. To that extent, we were framed when we were kids. So we were focused on women's issues, and we will support women, and we will lobby for women, and we will fight for women. So as we were opposition, but we were specific opposition during the old regime. We never called for the regime to go. We never even thought we should call for the regime to go. Shamefully, but it's true. But we focused and we fought very, very tough fights with the government to change laws for women.
But thank you, and go ahead. Please.